Testing, 1, 2, 3, 4. Hopefully this is picking up because this microphone's being rubbish. Let's try it. Hi guys, Mike here, One Go Short Play. Today we're going to do something a little different. I'm classing this as a talkie because it's going to be mostly me talking. But I did promise you over a few videos now, I've been going on about this Spectrum art that I drew. Games I'd have liked to have seen on the ZX Spectrum, but done with full colour, in the style of pretty much Shadow Warriors R-type Golden Axe. Captain Pytron, was it called? Pytron? Don't know, it was a game I played recently, well I played back in the day, didn't really like, but I loved the colour in it. And I played it again recently, and I still love the colour in it, but I still don't really like it, because it's not very well balanced. And it's actually better than I remember it being, but that's another story. We might get to that if we ever hit the Spectrum games, and let's face it, that could be a while away, but got to apologise, disclaimer, I've got a cold. It's only a little one, I've had it a couple of days. I had the cold throat thing and then it went to the coughing, sneezing, snot. You don't need to know this, but I'm going to tell you anyway, because in for a penny and all that. I've been through it, you can go through it with me. Today is quite fun, because I'm going to give you a bit of what I promised, which was to do some of my Spectrum stuff, to show you some of that. I went digging through an old hard drive and I found some. I haven't found it all, and some of the stuff I found got mangled because, as you know, Spectrum has what, 8 colours again, but not including black. Basically because it's got 8 colours: black, red, yellow, green, blue, cyan, turquoise, magenta, kind of pink, bearable thing, and white. Now, it also has versions of those colours with the lights down, which of course makes white grey, makes the pink purple, and so on. It gives you a couple of shades, but you can't, there's rules, you can't use the two shades of the same colour in the same square, because it's about having the light switched on or switched off. So, the other rule with the Spectrum is basically in the 8x8 squares, it's all in 8x8 squares, and in the colour attributes, and in the 8x8 square you can only have 2 colours at a time, which is cool. You can do some interesting stuff with multicolour, but you will get a bit of clash. But when I was a kid, I saw Ocean published it, Shadow Warriors for the Spectrum, and it blew my socks off, because it was the closest I would get to playing an arcade game on the Spectrum. Now, it was right at the end of the Spectrum's days, and it had its limitations. Yes, it moved in 8x8s. That didn't bother me. In fact, I always thought the frame rate was a bit too fast, and if you'd slowed down the frame rate, it would have made for a better game. I still think that's right. In fact, I did an experiment with that, and I'll show you in a minute. But, when I get through what I'm going to show you first. Basically, I wanted to experiment with moving things in 8x8 and what I could do with it. So I started just picking the games I loved and kind of porting them, if you like, over to the Spectrum, trying to keep the essence of them, using the graphics as reference and then building my own graphics based on that. But with those rules, 2 colours in an 8x8 square with the light switched on or the light switched off. Now, the first colour, the colour that sits on top, if you like, is black, and that's how you get that Shadow Warriors full colour look. It also means your game's limited to 8x8s. Not necessarily, depending on the amount of memory you've got. You can go nuts, and you can make things move smoothly if you're willing to do sets of animations that travel through the 8x8, what's it called, stencil. But that's a can of worms, and we won't even go down there for now. I just wanted to have some fun and kind of have a bit of fantasy game dev, if you like. I'd like making me little indie games, and I like making things for me just because I want to, because I can, because I practice, and I like practicing, I like having fun with it. So, without further ado, I think I will start to show you what I've made. This was before I started my latest indie game project. So this was a couple of years ago that I did these. I've had them out in frames at shows and stuff like that, and people have passed comments, and people have loved them, and people have not known what they were. I'm hoping you guys will know a bit about what they were. This first one is, remember I was a Sega kid, is a screenshot of a game I loved on the Mega Drive called Elisa Dragoon. As you can see, it abides by all of the rules, of the 8x8 two colours pair thing. And as you can see, it's very, very colourful, despite the limitations of the Spectrum being usually monochrome. I don't mind monochrome games. I like them because they're smooth. They can move pixel perfect. It's not necessarily important, though, if you can do it well, as I came to find out when I had a go at actually making something that would also obey these rules code-wise. I didn't do it on the Spectrum because I don't know how to. So that's Elisa Dragoon. I've got these in alphabetical order because they kind of come off the disc that way. And I'm just going to flick through them. Now, I was also a child of the Amiga. And I didn't really like any of the Street Fighter games on the Spectrum, any of the one-on-one fighting games. I don't think I saw one that got it right. Maybe Wade the Exploding Fist was pretty good for its age. But imagine if they got the nice one-button one-on-one fighter body blows in a nice fat sprites full colour. Yeah, alright, relatively slow frame rate. But wouldn't that look cool if they could have done that? Of course, I'd have loved to have been involved with that. I love body blows on the Amiga. Looking back, it's really dated badly. But back then, it was a thing of beauty. Looking back, the sprites weren't that well animated. But they had a certain charm to them, a certain style to them. I can't remember who drew them now. But I did love them at the time. And I could see that kind of the angles and the arms and stuff were a bit wrong. But that also lent itself quite well to making it on a Spectrum, because we're working in 8x8 squares, remember? So you can kind of, you know, you can exploit those straight lines and those diagonal lines, more the straight lines, of course, with those 8x8s. And you can see the black masking is really at work there. Now, it stands out, but if you can see past that, I found that much easier to see past than I did the monochrome or the colour clash on the Spectrum. I also was able to put up with 8x8 movements. If they slowed the frame rate down, which they didn't really do enough, Golden Axe, for example, on the Spectrum, which we're going to come back to in a minute. Oh, I did do a version of Golden Axe, but I couldn't find that. I just realised. So you can't see my Golden Axe, but there is something you can't see, so that's okay. Golden Axe, for example, on the Spectrum was done in full colour. Sprites were tiny, though. I mean, goodness only knows if a Spectrum could handle something with sprites as big as body blows. But I have seen it done. Was it the Great Gurianos had massive colour sprites? I'm sure the right programmer could do it. In fact, I had a conversation with Jim Bagley on Facebook. You probably won't remember it. Oh, you'll know this one, of course. Anyone who knows the retro games knows this. The Spectrum had a god-awful version of Double Dragon. I think that it could have had a brilliant version of Double Dragon. I've just seen a mistake, actually. It might be a mistake. If you look at the back of Billy Lee's hair there, it's got a red line. I'm not sure if it is a mistake. It might be all right. But don't worry, this is just me simulating. The art package I'm using, by the way, is ProMotion. I've used this since the days of Game Boy Advance. You will see, you will be starting to see some of my Game Boy Advance stuff coming through on the Games What I Have Made playlist. There will be more. I've used this package for years. I love it. It's absolutely brilliant for pixel art. It's great. As you can see, I've left everything in the screen. I'm hoping this is recording. Let me just double check. Yeah, it is. I've left the palette in the screen so you can see how the palette works over on the screen right there. Probably under my head to some extent, but you can edit that palette and get in there. It's brilliant. I can't sing its praises enough. So yeah, a screenshot from Double Dragon, the early part of Double Dragon. There's Avabo having just come out of the wall. Yes, that's it. A continuation of the level with the black Avabo. You can see the red kind of works to simulate the darker skin. It's as close as you can get to a tan or a brown skin colour. But you can do more with the enemy characters when you add colour. Yellow makes a good skin colour, as we've seen in a lot of Spectrum games. White is fine. Pink is pushing it. And red is great for darker skin tones. You can see there's massive black edges around those things. But when it moves, when these things move, I like it. I don't mind them at all. I think the black edges just add to it. Now, the way I've done the black edges is straight lines or diagonals. And that way, you're always within an 8x8 square. So you can stick any colour in the background and it will always sit on top nicely. Yeah, it looks a bit jagged sometimes. But the diagonals really help to smooth it, especially around the back of Billy and Jimmy. There you can see Jimmy in red. Same sprite, but in red. So really saving on memory, I guess, by just swapping palette. I don't know if it can be done like that. I assume it can. It's what they did in the Game Boy Advance when I was making games on that. E-swap, one I wasn't so happy with because I think there's a lot of white, essentially, and the black really stands out against it. Also, it's just not very elegant having so much detail going on. Those bricks are too detailed, it's too bright, it's too forefronted. You can't really tell the floor from the back wall, and I wasn't happy with that. And I'd probably do it again if I could be bothered, but I just wanted to have a little go with E-swap, and I wasn't really feeling it drawing E-swap anyway. Don't get me wrong, I love E-Swat, especially the Mega Drive version. This is actually a port of the arcade version that I've drawn here. I really wanted to draw the guy in the robot suit, but by the time I got through this one, I was kind of, I don't even want to draw a baddie. I'm just a bit bored of it. Move on, you know. As I say, don't say you kid. But when there's games like this to do instead, you just don't want to be hanging around with E-Swat, you know. Imagine that. That would work so well on the Spectrum. The 8x8 would really accommodate the stompy walk animation. It would be brilliant. Oh, I wish they'd done exactly that. I just... I'm lamenting that that doesn't exist. Imagine, I'd love to have seen Gods on the Spectrum. Da, 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 da. Doesn't even need music, which is great because the Spectrum wasn't great at doing music in-game. It could be done. It was done. But if it was a problem with frame rate and whatnot, obviously this would have a slightly slower frame rate than most Spectrum games. That would be the way the 8x8 kind of move in a nice gradiented way. It would work, trust me. Well, you don't have to trust me, you'll see in a minute. But basically what we've got there is an absolute fantasy for me as a teenager. I loved Gods. I wasn't very good at it. I think I only got to the second level, like midway through the second level. It did get quite hard very quickly. And I didn't own a copy for a long time. My friend Owen had a copy of Gods, and his dad, if I remember rightly, was really good at it. I loved it. It was beautiful. Look at the muscle tone in his legs. Even on the Spectrum, it comes through. Look at the anatomy of the characters. So nicely done. I've seen a remake of Gods recently for the PC. No one was really impressed with the graphics. And I felt bad for the guy who's doing it. Because he's really trying. And he's, you know, I know how it feels. I've been the indie developer making something that doesn't look as good as the professional stuff. While trying to be a professional artist as well. And you're just constantly chasing the industry all the time. And there are people at the top of the game for a while, but then they always fall behind, and it's just how the industry works. And seeing this guy trying to make Gods, he's just trying to... Well, the team's, it's a small team, they're having a go. You know, so many of us are like, why bother messing with it? Because it's the perfect thing. But why not, you know? And I like that they're having a go. I wish that it was better. I think it will be better when it's done. While they're trying to bring Gods forward to you know, modern gaming, which I don't think you can do really without making a whole new game like they did Shadow of the Beast, for example. While they're doing that, I'm going to have my little Spectrum fantasies with it. That would be brilliant, and I don't care what anyone else says. I'd love to see that. I'm looking at that, I'm tempted to try and make the game. And not for the Spectrum itself, because I wouldn't know where to start. By the way, if there's any good Spectrum programmers who want to help, you know... make these things come to life, then I'm happy to get involved. Nightmare. Now, I was having a phase, I was working at home part-time and I was freelancing. I can't remember. I was either freelancing or working for a little mobile company at the time. Anyway, I found that I'd come in here in the lounge for me lunch, and I'd stick some telly on for an hour, and I found that Challenge was doing Nightmare. And I just got into it. I taped it, you know, and every lunchtime I come and watch a couple of episodes. My goodness, it was great. And my little game design brain started thinking, why did they make it so badly on the Spectrum? Why didn't they just go, there's the game design. There's the game design on the telly. Right, if you go into that room and on the table is available these three items, chances are the next room will be Lilith, for example. And she will want... either the pearl necklace or the comb for her hair. Something for grooming herself with, because that's the formula. So if you see the pearl necklace, get it, because you don't need the dagger, because Lilith's coming up and she's going to want the pearl necklace. You know, there's certain items that she always wanted in the TV show, and you're shouting it at the screen if you're watching them in bulk, which I was doing. Yeah, quite pathetic, I know. And then she'd remove the, she'd, you know, give the right thing, she'd give you the bridge. Give the wrong thing, she'd remove the bridge from under your feet and you'd die. And you know, that it was that brutal, and I don't need to explain Nightmare to you guys there. But again, how cool would this have been if they just simulated the TV show? The artwork's there, copy it. Oh, they made this Well, if you've seen the game, you know. If you haven't seen the game, just go on YouTube it. You'll see, and people are disappointed. It wasn't the team. Check out an episode, if you don't know what I'm talking about, check out an episode of Nightmare, with a K, the TV show for kids from the 80s. Google that or YouTube that. It is there. And then YouTube, the Spectrum game. I think it might have even been an Amiga version. Oh, there wasn't an Amiga version. It was something else again. Equally bad. All they needed to do was this. Imagine that. The, what's it, I can't remember what that thing's called now. The Catacomb Bite. Something like that. Catacomb Bite. Big massive skull on skeleton legs with... It just kind of did a set animation and you had to guide your dungeon here. Now, I'm not saying you have to shout left and right like they do on the TV show. You can do it with keyboard controls. You can rotate them with keyboard controls. They can be more complex to simulate the difficulty of telling the, you know, on-screen person where to go. There's ways to do that. You have a rotation and walk forward. You could have a sidestep button. Something like that. I hadn't even thought that through. What I was thinking through was the game mechanics of the TV show. It's a video game on telly. That's how they sold it. That's how it was so successful. All they had to do in the video game was copy that formula. Oh, I'm getting angry. I'm not angry. I'm passionate about this stuff. I was a kid when this was out. I was the one who was disappointed by what was released, you know. Maybe you think I'm wrong. Maybe you loved the game. I didn't, and I was gutted. I wanted to see that head in the bottom corner. It's behind my head right now. If I can in the edit, I'll move my head over the screen for this bit, just so you can see the nightmare character head. Obviously, the bits of armor, that's your energy bar, the bits of armor fall off and you become a skull. Even if you can't animate that on the Spectrum, you could take it out in squares, you know, like they did in Batman the movie or something, where it changes from Batman to the Joker. Something like that, even an 8x8 square at a time to the next stage. Ugh, why didn't they do that? In fact, this is, I called these, if they'd let me make it on the Speccy or something like that. And if they'd let me make Nightmare on the Speccy, it would have been like that. And it would have been great. It actually would have been great. Back to the Amiga. Moonstone. I know, I'm getting optimistic here. But that's the whole point. It's about me being optimistic. Now, what you will notice here is, all right, aside from that big slanted line on the Balak's leg, you can barely see any of the black masking. Which is great. I was kind of getting the hang of that. These weren't done in this order, by the way. So the ones that look a bit rubbish were earlier. but Moonstone, something's buzzing. I think it's a phone. Someone's trying to contact me, I think. I'm just trying to ignore it. Moonstone is... Let me check. It's not my phone. No, it's not. Moonstone is one of those games. Possibly the best Amiga game for me. That's a big... I know that's a big statement. I think several times it's come up, my favourite Amiga game is Moonstone. It's awesome. I'm actually making a beat 'em up at the minute, a brawler, a Double Dragon looking brawler. It's actually much simpler than that. I played Double Dragon on 2600 and I went for that kind of look, but better. Because I was impressed by it. But I always wanted to make a Double Dragon style brawler with the Moonstone style map. I actually did a treatment once for Renegade 4, which never got made, when I was running a little games company in Liverpool about 15 years ago now. I will dig out screenshots for that. Actually, I'll put it in the games what I have made, because I'll do a section on games that never got made. And if I can find enough screenshots of it, I did do a design document for that Renegade 4. It would have been good. I was planning on using a city map, but I'm using that idea in a little game I'm making over on Psychotic Software, Psysoft on Twitter, if you're interested, that uses this Moonstone map idea. And it does it slightly differently, but it, you know, the basis of it is the Moonstone map. I'm basically shamelessly nicking the best bits of the best games, from, in my opinion, that made me love brawlers and fighting games like this, or progress-based fighting games that weren't one-on-one. Anyway, Moonstone, there it is. You can see the simplicity of those knights. It's one knight with different palettes, so you'd have the red, you'd have the green, you'd have the yellow. The monsters, yeah, you'd have to simplify the animations. That goes for all of these Spectrum games, just to get the memory to work. But that's the fun of it, as the artist, choosing the best frames, choosing how to make that work, how to make that simplification work. Now, I'm probably going to have to do this video in a few parts, because my other half, Jo, is upstairs getting our Lucas to sleep, and she's going to be down in a bit. So if I have to stop, I have to stop, because, you know, I'm fitting this in around real life. But let's move on and see if we can get it all done at once. Now, a game I hated on the Spectrum, but loved on the arcade. Most other people hated on the arcade, but I don't care. I loved it. Pit Fighter. Now, it was because of the photographed characters. That was a great idea. I did try it once at university. I did make a little brawler called the Damn Good Kicking. I made several versions of it. I do talk about it on the games, what I have made. And the very first version I made, in fact, I should have probably included it, was one with a few of my friends photographed walking around battering each other. And it was all right. Well, the controls were terrible because I hadn't figured that out. But it was all right. But I loved Pit Fighter. I loved the way it looked. It was a precursor to Mortal Kombat for that look. And there's a few other games around that style. The arcade game was good. It was a money grabber, but it was good. I did beat it on the arcade with, I think, £4. It must have been more than that. It was in Video City and Hunts Cross and Mackett's Lane. Incidentally, apparently the same road that George Harrison grew up on, which is at the end of my road. Anyway, that's by the by. I loved that game. That Video City in the 80s had a lot, in the early 90s as well, had a lot of good arcade games in there, like Data East stuff, and Double Dragon turned up there, and Pit Fighter, and I battered most of them. Pit Fighter was one of them. Also a game called Mutant Fighter. That was a Data East one, like a wrestling game, which I loved because it was creepy looking, but it never really gained popularity. Anyway, massive sprites, and you'll see, look closely at the background, they're all exactly the same, except for the characters are all the same. They'd be two-frame animations of the same three or four characters. There's a guy on the side there who'd be... that was what would push you back in, but obviously they'd have to be the right size to do that, so I'm not quite sure what I was thinking with that. But I'm sure I had something in mind. You can see now the floor's the interesting bit. It's blue there. It was yellow in the last one, but it's the same thing. It's got these black lines across it. Now, if I remember rightly, they go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 6, no, to 8. In 8, basically, increments of, you know, 4 times. They grow and shrink, and that's how you get the impression that you're moving in and out of the screen. The original Spectrum version of this was terrible. YouTube it, and then compare the way it looks with this. And you'll see why I really wanted to just try and do this. I don't think... the sprites are massive. They wouldn't move in and out of the screen, which is a shame, because the Spectrum version actually does that to its credit. But these ones would stay put, but the background would kind of stretch and shrink. It would give the impression with those black lines of stretching and shrinking, while you wouldn't actually get any closer to the back of it. You'd be basically set there. You could move... The idea was that you could move up and down a little bit from the other character, but they'd never shrink and grow, because... Well, he couldn't do it with those colours in place. It's just too limited. So it was kind of a limited idea, and it was kind of flawed. Let me just... I've got another screenshot of this here somewhere, but I seem to have misplaced it. I have totally misplaced it. Oh, well. I'm going to see if I can find it. Bear with me. I'll pause and start this if I... There it is. I found it. Okay, same again. As you can see, we're in the middle of the level now, so we've moved away from the sides. I think that's how it works. The background would just be the back wall and a little bit there, but you'd never actually get into it. And when you go off the side too much, someone would step in and push you back in. That's the idea. There's Kato. I've got all the player characters in and three of the baddies. Looks good. I'm sure it would be a pretty bad version, but it would look good. And it would probably be better than the actual Spectrum version of the game, which I bought. I have memories of that one, of going to town and buying that. First time I went to town by myself, I think in Liverpool, and I went to Bits and Bytes, I think it was, in Central Station, so I didn't venture far, because it was in Central Station, and I bought Pit Fighter in the wooden the cardboard box. I've since sold that to the school I used to work at, so they could put it in their arcade, because I don't need that stuff lying around in my office. I don't play hard copy Spectrum games anymore. Although, this whole new Spectrum Next thing I might have to check out. Anyway, off on a tangent. Now, moving on. Pit Fighter, could be cool. Oh yeah, Child of the Amiga. Anyone who knows the Amiga knows this. Shadow of the Beast, the original Shadow of the Beast. I was talking about it a minute ago. Imagine that. The Spectrum version was actually, it had a certain something to it. It was Gremlin. And it had the thing that really captured, well, worked for me that evoked the Shadow of the Beast thing was the music on the Spectrum. It was beautiful. It had twinkles and the Spectrum sounds kind of worked for it. The game wasn't that nice though to look at. The parallaxing was, I don't think it was even there. It might have been two layers of it. What if you look closely at this, what I've done here is, all right, the mountains have got massive black edging, but I don't think it matters because what you've got there is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, possibly five layers of parallax on those clouds. The back stripe is two layers. They can move in one pixel at a time because it's all pink and black, but with black in front of it, so there'll be no clash if they move at one at a time. If the foreground moves, I think what it was, yeah, if the foreground moves at 8x8, that the clouds can move at any speed they want because they're all one color and everything else is masked over it. That was the idea. So those clouds, I think it was something, I actually worked it out. I think the actual gameplay was 8x8. The fence in the foreground was 16, sort of moving 16s. And then the top row of clouds was 4, the next row was 2, then and the next was 1. you can mess with those numbers, you know, and as long as it's kind of going in 8s, it works pretty well. But that said, it was just something I was experimenting with. I haven't actually seen it animate, but I know it'll work because I've painstakingly worked out the way that would all go together. And then I added the trees and a few more details, some baddies and stuff. And obviously it's running in the right direction. Shadow of the Beast, of course, throws you off on one because it says go right, and really it means go left. And that gave the original game a sort of sense of open world, and I loved it. I know it was a very simple game. I know it was flawed, very, very flawed playability-wise, and really you had to cheat to beat it. I'm sure some people have managed it. Now, you can see on the trees, there's a lot of optimism here. Those trees have got a lot of tiles to them. There are ways to simplify that, and I'd probably go through and do that and try and make them kind of out of 10 tiles, you know, each kind of green area of the tree. It can be done. I've done that sort of thing before. But I wanted to be optimistic. I've designed one tree there. I think it might be two, might be another variant just behind that boulder and just behind the bass. That was pretty much all I thought it needed, you know, art asset wise, until you get to the other details like the well and whatnot. And you can join those trees together and make quite a dense wood. It's about optimizing the content you've got. The fence, for example, is just the same tile over and over again. It's the same on the Amiga. It doesn't matter. It was the effect that worked, the effect that mattered. So I was just trying to simulate that with the spectrum, and I think I achieved it quite well. As you can see, the clouds are all on one pink layer. In fact, there's two shades of pink to give it a gradient with different levels of dithering. Just playing about with it. And when you zoom out of it, and you're not looking at it as pixels, but you're looking at it as a composition, it works really well. In fact, can we do that? No, we're doing it. Let's do it by hand. Ah, there you go. It gives you an idea. Anyway. Moving on. Oh, yeah. Shinobi. Now, this was done just after Eastwatch. As I say, I was a Sega kid. I'd learned, though, that ESWAT one really didn't work, and Shinobi one wasn't either, because the backgrounds are kind of yellow. That's the colour really of the level, and if you try and change it to something darker, like the dark blue you can see in the parallax background I've got there, that was to work in parallax. You can see it would be too bright, it'd just sit in front of everything, the arms of the characters would get lost in it, and you've got to kind of find ways around that. And okay, it's not, let me just turn the, excuse me while I turn the baby monitor on. Okay. I think that means Joe's coming down and we'll have to resume tomorrow if that's alright with you. Yep, the baby monitor's on. There we go. Okay. What I've done there is I've did the background with black. It's the only option you have, really. You can see it works. Someone told me on a CRT monitor that would look a bit dodgy. It kind of wobble while it moves. Hey, it's a price I'm willing to pay. I've got the effect I want. On a modern monitor, it'll look great. But they're probably right. On an old monitor, it would probably wobble. I'd like to see it. I'd like to see what it does. Incidentally, just to point out, the original Shinobi runs in 8x8s anyway, but it's all monochrome. Why didn't they just do that? I don't get it. I'm sure there's reasons, and it's to do with budget and time more than anything else, but, you know, I'm not going to get too frustrated about it. It means I can have fun making these myself. Shinobi 3, imagine that. Graphically, a massive improvement on the original Shinobi, of course, but we're talking a few games in by now. And we'd have the Shadow Dancers, which I wish I'd done some screenshots of, but I haven't. In fact, the special version of Shadow Dancer, I loved it. It was great. It played really well. Yeah, it was monochrome, but the music was there. Was the music there? I'm thinking the Amiga version. It was good anyway. It was a good version. It was slick and smooth, and I enjoyed it as a kid. This was the best Shinobi game, in my opinion, Shinobi 3. I've missed a few. I know there's a few later ones. I've got the PS2 one, which I've never played, but I'm hearing it's just frustrating. Rather than good. It's a different type of game. But I've got to watch the Baba while Joe goes to Lou. So I've got one eye on the Baba while I do this. This is the reality of having babies, boys and girls. Okay. Now, she can probably hear me saying all this. She's not answering if she can. Now, Shinobi 3, beautiful game. I've had to very much simplify the game's content. As you can see, the rocks on the foreground mountains are very, very simple. There's only a few tiles in the background ones and the stalactites hanging down. I can't remember. Mites, tites. Yeah, anyway. Very, very simple, very repetitive. But when it's moving fast and you're belting through it, awesome. It has a walk and a run in Shinobi 3. I'd probably do the walk in 8x8, but every other frame, so it would jerk a little bit. I don't know. I haven't tried it. I'd try it. I'd mess about with it. Let's move on. This is cool. You ready for this? Streets of Flipping Rage. Can you imagine Streets of Rage on the Spectrum? The Target Renegade beta? Maybe not. Nothing beats Target Renegade. That is my favourite brawler of all time. I think I share that opinion with Lone Boys Post, with Dave. I was made up when he mentioned Target Renegade. He might have put it number 2, I can't remember. But it is the best brawler. In context, it's the best beat-em-up that's ever been made. For many reasons, which we won't go into on this video. Streets of Rage 2, though, was a close second. This was my go to Streets of Rage 1, because I thought that would translate better to the Spectrum, because the sprites are smaller. I'm sure we can't have that many sprites on the screen, but, hey, you know, with the right programmer, who knows what's possible. Very recognisable first level, as you can see. And then I tried another level just to see if that was a fluke. And no, it came out really well. We all know where we are in the game there. I think that was actually a work in progress of that level. I think I included the big... I did definitely include the big stomper as well. God knows what's happened to that finished screenshot, though. I found these as animations, actually. In fact, if I go to the next frame... No, there you go. So you can see the process on these. Well, some of the process... but I'm sure there was more to this one with the stomper coming down. Never mind, it's cool. There's Adam, there's Blaze. Axel was in the previous one. You can recognise all the baddies. Yes, they'd move in 8x8s, but they work. They will move in 8x8s. I'm sure it would be a bit jumpy. The frame rate wouldn't be perfect, but that's great. If having lots of characters on the screen affects the frame rate and drops it, why not just drop it to 12 frames a second anyway? And alright, it'll be running at 12 frames a second, but it'll still be good, it'll still work, it'll still play, you can still make it feel like the game, and I will prove that point in a minute. Super Frog, again for the Amiga. Someone said you could probably do this really well with flip screen, but I don't see it working on flip screen. It has to be a platformer, really. 8x8, keep the tiles down by basically reusing everything that you can see on that screen there. That'll be the whole level content, maybe the occasional extra detail, like, you know, the little hole with the door or whatever that it goes into. And a few other things, bouncy stuff and that. But most of the level's detail is there on that screen. You just tile map that around the level. And that'd be awesome. I also did the castle level. Very similar. Most of the content is there already. I actually did it too big. That's why the door and the bouncy thing goes off the bottom of the screen there. Because I just shrunk it down to make it Spectrum size. But I did it 320 by 240. Spectrum is 256 by 192. I think that's right. I'm pretty sure that's right. It was a while ago I drew these. But look at the way the Spectrum can be made to simulate the light on the wall of the torch, you know. And you can just do a 2-frame on that. Or maybe a 3-frame. A 3-frame would be nice, wouldn't it? On the flame movement itself. Maybe make that sprite, I don't know. Or just flip it left and right. I don't know. I haven't tried anything with it. But as you can see, it works. It's super fun, clearly. It would move in 8x8. It might be a little jerky. My Baba is moving. Disturbing a little bit. Just a little bit. He's alright. Now, I'm going to leave that there because I've got a few more to come. But Joe's just come down now. So I'm going to pause the video and tomorrow we'll continue. Okay. So yeah, we'll carry on tomorrow from Super Frog and I'll wrap it up now. I think that's working. Hi guys, Mike here, back again. We're on the next night. Last night I showed you my Spectrum art up to Super Frog. Let's carry on. It was actually the Super Frog one that I spoke to Jim Bagley about. I got halfway through telling you about that and then went off on a tangent. As I say, Jim won't remember this. It was a conversation we had last year on Facebook, quite a brief one, where someone commented on these Super Frog shots. And we had a conversation about whether it was realistic to actually expect to be able to make this. And I, of course, well, I took it to Jim Bagley, who's, if you don't know who Jim Bagley is, he's basically one of the most famous British Spectrum programmers. Spectrum was a very British thing. I think Jim, yeah, Jim worked for Ocean back in the day, amongst other many other massively memorable companies. He did a lot of very famous games. My favourite, most notable one from him was Midnight Resistance, which I've talked about before. Loved that game. I loved it on the Amiga specifically. I played it at my friend Luke's house. He had an Amiga before I did. And then I had a Spectrum at the time, and suddenly it was out on the Spectrum, so I got myself a copy. And, of course, it's not the Amiga version, it's a Spectrum. It's like this stuff. But it was brilliant. It moved in 8x8, funnily enough. I think it did. I need to check out with Jim. I'm pretty sure it did. Again, why they didn't do this masking thing, I don't know. But, you know, I don't know as much about this stuff as other people did. So I'm making huge assumptions when I do this artwork about what the Spectrum would be capable of. I'm sure there'll be a lot less animation allowed than I'd like to give it. But that's kind of an artist's prerogative to want to do more visuals and animation and beautiful things than is allowed. And sometimes you get more through than you'd expect to. So, you know. Anyway, let's carry on from Super Frog. It was during Super Frog once, and someone was telling me about it would make a good flip screen game, and I wanted to do it scrolling, that I had a chat with Jim Bagley about, would it actually be possible to do this on the Spectrum? And he said something to the tune of, which is why I always say it, with the right programmer, anything's possible. okay, kind of non-committal, but also kind of encouraging. And I was happy with that. You know, I never intend to make any of these games because I wouldn't know where to start. I don't think I could get a programmer like someone like Jim, for example, who would have the time to be able to put into something like this, which is clearly non-profit and clearly wouldn't have much of a financial viability to it. So, you know, this is for fun. Most of the things I do are pretty much unsustainable financially, but I do it for the love of it. Metroid. Now, as I say, I was a Sega and Amiga kid, and a Spectrum kid, of course. It was years later that I played Metroid. I actually got a copy of Metroid for my GBA, or it was a Nintendo DS by then, but you could play GBA games on it, and Game Boy games as well. In fact, it might be on the Game Boy Advance, actually. Anyway, either way, some Nintendo handheld 16-bit device, which was brilliant. I love their handheld stuff. After the Game Boy, I didn't have one of them. The original Metroid was something I played and didn't really get. It was too hard. It was a good game, but it was too hard. And I think that was just because I didn't put enough time into it. Then I played Super Metroid on the SNES. Emulated, of course. Have you seen the price of that game on eBay? Joe, my partner, was gutted because she did have a SNES when we were like college age. And she absolutely adored this game, Super Metroid. Quite right, too. It is brilliant. I mean, I worked on a Metroidvania, we call it, the genre. Huge platform game with loads of rooms, basically, and lots of things to unlock and lots of things to explore. Hidden areas, loads of level bosses, power-ups, level-ups, you know, that kind of thing. Metroidvania, Castlevania meets Metroid. They're from the same sort of genre. As I say, large platform games. I worked on that genre of game for a popular license, which will come to in my games, what I have made. By the time some people have seen this, it will already be in there, so you'll know what I'm talking about. And I loved working on it, and then I played Metroid and realised how good a game it was. again, what I did is I took my reference from the SNES version, all the bits that I thought I'd like to try and make for the Spectrum. And then I built this very basic town. It's even more basic than it looks. If you look closely at this screen, you'll see how simple it is and how few tiles there actually are in it. But isn't that great what I managed to achieve with very few tiles? I was really impressed with how this game looked. I'd got to grips by this point with creating dark backgrounds for sprites to pop out of. Remember that eSwap one that I showed you yesterday? Well, earlier in this video. What a contrast this is to that. Exactly the same technique, but this time I'm using the dark blue in the palette to create a back wall. It's pretty much what Metroid did, maybe with a slightly different, well, with a very different palette. But as you can see here, I do think I've captured the look of Metroid in a game that would run in 8x8. We dropped the frame rates of it, something around 12 frames a second. As I say, it doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're playing it, it works fine. And I will show you that. And we've got full colour, a game that moves in full colour. Yeah, it's a bit choppier than the SNES version, but it would work. And we can, if we need to, we can reduce animations and reduce the tiles. And we'll still have the essence of Metroid. I did another screen for this. I didn't get very far in it when I was playing it on the SNES, to be fair, but I did love it. You don't have to get far in the game to love it. As you can see, this uses most of the same tiles, but I wanted to build the first level boss. I don't think on the SNES version it's symmetrical like this. It might be, I can't remember. It's a while ago we did this. But what we've got there is the first level. I think it's the first level boss, and the big plant thing that shoots things at you. I've had to limit the way it can fight so that it, you know, it can run on a spectrum, essentially, with the 8x8 thing. We'd have to slow down the kind of seed pods it fires and you know, play with it to make it work for the spectrum. You can't just port directly from a higher end device. You have to kind of make compromises in the way it plays to fit with the limitations of the device. And that's the fun of it. That's the cool bit about making this stuff. I think that would have been brilliant on the spectrum. I'm sure Nintendo would never have licensed it. I mean, did we see Mario and anything but Nintendo devices? No. In fact, they stonewalled anything that was similar to it. Gianna Sisters, I'm looking at you. Metroid, though, I think, I don't know, I think they tried Castlevania on the Amiga, didn't they, and it was terrible. Someone did it, I'm not sure how official that was. But hey, anyway, I'm not doing this officially. I just wanted to see what Metroid would look like in full colour on a spectrum, and that's what I came up with, and I really liked that. I was really proud of that one. Moving on, I wasn't so proud of this, but I still do love it, and I love the game. It's an Amiga game, it's Wolfchild. One of the first games I owned for the Amiga. When I got mine at Christmas 92, I think, 91 maybe, so early, right at the beginning of 92 was when I think I was into the Amiga. Anyway, around that time, there were a lot of really good, beautiful games out, and this one was one of course games, gorgeous, gorgeous platformer, really atmospheric, great music, lovely parallax, and as you can see with the clouds in the background, I've separated that layer again, so it's just red and black, and also everything else on the frontal platform layer moves in 8x8, so that means those clouds can parallax, and I think I did design them to just about cut on the 8x8 line so that you can actually make them parallax. I might not have done that, I can't remember, it might just move, but that level was kind of beautiful for the fact that the clouds were always scrolling. You were on a big airship moving at high speed, basically his hair blew in the wind that way, and then when he turned around it blew that way, and it was just such a nice touch, and I wanted to include it on this, and I might have even drawn it in some of the sprite animations. I did a few animations, and I'd kind of take the frames I liked and make a screenshot out of it. That was what I did most of the time. I do have some sprites lying about here as well, but I won't bore you with those right now. The Golden Axe ones in particular had loads of sprites, sheets of sprites, everything in the game, basically. I'm getting ahead of myself. Wolfchild for the Amiga, those who loved it, as I did, will hopefully recognise that for how cool it is and how cool it could look on the spectrum. Yeah, the thing I don't like about it is to achieve that blue gradient effect using the dithering and whatnot. In fact, there's an extra dot there. I'm not sure it should be there. Anyway, but to achieve, I love that what I achieved with the metal pipes sticking up, you know, in the background, the blue to red light effect. That's really cool. Looking back, that's really cool. What I really don't like is how prominent the black outlines are in this one, because it's just against the blue. Not too bad when it gets toward the black and the gradients. And I think that's where Metroid really worked. Let's just go back to that. As you can see, she blends with the background. Same there. They're still present, but there's a much better blend than there is with Wolfchild there. Again, these are just all experimental. I'm sure Wolfchild would look like everyone's kind of encased in black plastic, you know, black plastic bags around them or something. But hey, these are the breaks. I'm still happy with the way that looks. I love the way the characters look. I'm not sure I like the way Saul, was it his name, looks there, because it's blue and yellow. It's very Captain Patron. Blue bottom, yellow top. And I've tried to bring up the knee pads with the lighter cyan. But the body, the top of the body, you don't really see the big metal rings around the shoulders, which I think are to do with turning him into a wolf, because the intro in the Amiga version kind of suggests it. But I couldn't bring that out because I was limited by the 8x8 squares, and every time I tried to add colour to those, it just went wrong, it looked wrong. So I had to stick it all skin tone, and I think it suffers for that. And maybe I could have repositioned it within the 8x8 shape, but then I'm losing his body shape from the Amiga version, and it starts to not look like him, if that makes sense. So I was really compromising and walking a very tight line with making Saul look like Saul. That was as close as I could get him at the time. I'm sure with a bit more work I could get him looking better. It probably would look better with them animated, because he had a very, very distinctive run animation, which is kind of a weird, goofy thing. But when you and single frames, it looks really bad. But when you see it run, it's great. And there's a single frame, so it's never going to look that good. But hey, Wolfchild could look good on the spectrum too. And I think it would work. I think the 8x8 thing would work. And you'd all forgive me for making 8x8 games when you played it. Now, this is something else. I'm not sure what we're going to find now. This is, we're moving into kind of messy territory now. I wanted to make, when I was a kid, I was mad on Thundercats, the cartoon. I loved it. I loved the way everything looked and felt. I loved the original artist's sketches of the characters. Monkey kind of stood up on his toes and stuff like that. And I loved the way they were drawn. And it kind of really influenced the way I drew things at the time. And of course, my hand and my muscles in my hand memorized those kind of shapes and lines. I started drawing like that. Then I saw the Spectrum game. I was so excited about it. And then I saw screenshots and I was like, oh, it doesn't look like Thundercats to me. And then I played the game. And it was basically, I don't know if anyone played Vixen, a terrible game. I think it was made by Martek, the same people that did Blind Panic on the Spectrum. Correct me if I'm wrong. I'm going from memory. I completed Blind Panic and at the end it said, look out for our next game, Vixen. Anyway, Thundercats on the Spectrum was like that. It looked like it had been made with the same engine. It was weak. It was a weak game. I don't care what people say about it. It was a weak game. And I remember the music wasn't the music from the cartoon. It was like this. It was a good tune for a game that wasn't from any license. But they just disregarded the license except for one big promo front-end screen. And then the rest of it, Lionel looked weak. The mutants, they were the right characters, but they looked weak. So I revised them. Is he asleep? Brilliant. Wow. Last night he didn't go to sleep. And we had a nightmare. Tonight he's gone to sleep. So I'm going to cut off there. And this video is going to be three parts by the looks of it. But hey, that was my Thundercats attempt. As you can see, the characters look great. They're massive though, so the game would be slowed down by that. It would have to be a different game. I was just playing. But the colours look good. I'm cuddling cats and dogs. There's an army of cats and dogs lying next to me. You can't see it. But that's what it is. We'll move on tomorrow. There's a few more I want to show you, and then I'm going to show you a game I programmed. And by programmed, I mean I made it in Shockwave to simulate the look of a Spectrum game. But it's a game I wanted to make just to test the 8x8 thing and the frame rate thing. We'll come to it tomorrow. I'm sorry that I can't do it tonight. We don't have the time. So tomorrow it is. But trust me, it'll be good. Okay, thanks for watching. I'll see you tomorrow. Hi, guys. Mikey, one go short play. Being very quiet. Now, this is kind of day three for you, but day four for me, because last night I tried to record part three, and ironically, when I was recording that, I made a big apology for the sound quality on this microphone. It's awful, and it's because my laptop sits on my lap. The microphone is underneath the laptop. Really stupid place to put it anyway, and it was muffling a lot. It has been on the games, and I've noticed that. Recently, just watching them back and thinking, uh-oh, I may go up to my office and get my big microphone and do this properly. Sorry to the people who felt you had to stop following my channel because of it. Hey, I'm about to improve it, but it's probably too late for you guys. Never mind. I'm always living and learning as I go along. I'm trying to find streamline ways to do this, to keep producing stuff, but mostly to keep it fun for me. This is my gaming time. This is pretty much all the time I get to game, apart from about 2 hours a few weeks ago where I bought Elite Dangerous with some birthday money I got, which I've been saving for something I really wanted, and then found it wasn't very fun. Or at least I'm not enjoying it, but I'm not a very technical gamer. I really want to be, but anyway, that's another story for another day. Hello, Russ. What about cats? Yeah, so sorry about that. Last night I recorded this, and I got really frustrated because it didn't record properly, and I'm having to do it again for next morning. I'm full of cold. It keeps coming back. I can't quite get rid of it. And I am very sweaty, and a big sweaty lump, basically, because I've been running this morning. I made it up myself. I've knocked it up from 9 minutes last week to 16 minutes this week. That's quite good. That's another 7 minutes, maybe twice as much. Anyway, you don't want to know about that. You want to know about this, hopefully. We were talking about my Thundercats game. Lionel and Monkey in there, really big sprites. I made a kind of a brawler out of it. I wasn't happy with any of the other graphics I did, so I'm just showing you this bit. But I think I'd actually kind of like to try and reproduce the platformer of the original, but set it in Third Earth with the locations of Third Earth, and make it obviously Third Earth, rather than just those random Vixen style platforms, which were, let's face it, rubbish. And didn't sum up there at all. Now, moving on. This is the very first Spectrum shot I tried. And you can kind of tell in that the characters in this are very, very square, as in the hands that stick forward to make that square shape of the square colours. I was working very, very much to the squares. And this is before I realised I can kind of loosen it up a bit, as long as I use the black outline thing. Now, this doesn't use the black outline thing particularly, which is kind of cool, but you can see the cost of that is to make everything very square. It's kind of good. Show it if you recognise the game. If you don't, it's Target Renegade for the Spectrum. I don't think for a minute I could make a better version of Target Renegade for the Spectrum. But it was possibly my favourite game on the Spectrum. I like brawlers, and Target Renegade is still up there for me as the best brawler that's out there in context of its age, and what was around before it, and what, you know, what was available in comparison to it. The Renegade series, if you don't know, went on to spawn the Double Dragon series for the arcades, but Imagine bought the rights for it to make computer versions. Was it Taito? I can't remember who owned it. No, Tecmo? I can't remember. Who owned the rights to the arcade said, yeah, off you go. We've got something else in the works, and that turned out to be Double Dragon. Anyway, Renegade was a brilliant game, and Target Renegade, the sequels for the 8-bits, was better because it had progression in it. I loved it. I wanted to remake the graphics and make it full colour like Shadow Warriors. Obviously, moving an 8x8 totally loses its fluidity, but I did do some experiments with this, with the sprites that were basically about moving between the 8x8 squares during the animation. That would, of course, mean the character would have to stop on the 8x8 while the player's controlling it. So it would mean when you let go of a key, the character may run a couple of frames before it stops. That, of course, added a delay to the playability. I might totally ruin the game, probably will, but it was an experiment, and I felt like experimenting. I did a lot of screenshots of it. As you can see, the quality of this one is a mess on the right there, screen right, or there, if you're to you. and the palette's totally messed up. That's because I couldn't find the original image. It's out there somewhere on my hard drives, CDs, whatever, DVDs, but this is the best I can find at short notice. It's off Facebook. I put it up on Facebook a while ago, saved it back down, and it was JPEG compressed to this state, and you can see it's not good. Same applies to this image. This is the second level of Target Renegade in the on the street scene with the hookers and the pimp. And as you can see, the hookers look a lot more feminine. The pimp looks a lot more pimp-like, I think. I've just tried to accentuate their features. They've got that weird mace, which has no place in the street scene. It's like a medieval weapon. I always thought that someone had written in this design for the game, mace. You know, let's try a cannon mace. And that happened. no one questioned it, which is funny. But I don't know. It's cool, the game's brilliant, and I was trying to reproduce it there. I think I had quite a lot of luck doing that. I quite like the way I used the black as a colour rather than just a mask. That's something I didn't really do afterwards. But I like it. It does get lost a bit in some of the background colours, but it's great. Target Renegade for the Spectrum, ladies and gentlemen. Target Renegade. I also lost Final Fight. I've got a Final Fight image somewhere, this one in particular. Basically an animation that develops the characters. And then this final image of some of the characters in situ. As you can see, Guy, Hagger, Roxy, Jay, I think that is, not Toopy, and Damned. With Damned's first level background, I was always annoyed with the Spectrum version. While the sprites were gorgeously big, they were just roughly ported from other versions. Possibly the Amiga, because controls worked the same way. What really killed it for me was left or right and fire. Shouldn't do a jump kick to the side, it should do attack moves, you should have to push up diagonally to go up to jump. Anyway, it annoyed me, and I'm sure there was reasons he did that, but the game felt, as a result, floaty and basically just not very good. And I thought it could at least, if it's got the big sprites and it's got the really slow frame rate, it could at least have colour in there. And I know they had time constraints and whatnot, but I don't know why they didn't do colour. I'm sure someone with more expertise than me knows why. But it's not really about that. For me, this is about seeing if I can do colour on it. And you can see the squares really interfere with the characters there. You can see the squares, especially in Roxy's hair there. But I love it, and I really enjoyed making this. Shame I can't find the original, but you can see the essence of it there. The original, of course, has just the original 15 colour palette there. But yeah, we've got the essence of it there, and I'm quite happy with that. Now, First of all, sorry I'm talking a bit quietly. It's the next morning, so Joe's not trying to get Lucas to sleep. Joe is asleep. And I've got to be as unintrusive as possible. I don't want to wake them up. Partly because if I wake them up, they come down. This video's over. If I... they need to sleep as well. Anyway. Now, I promised you a moving one. I'm gonna give you that. Sorry, I'm using the mouse while talking. I know I can't hear it, but you can. So I'll try not to do that. Let's just put things on hold. And we'll get started. Right. Here it is. Now, I made this in Shockwave for fun. Basically, what was happening was, in fact, let's just start it and you can enjoy it and I'll tell you about it as we go. If I click on it. Okay, so there I was doing the Golden Axe artwork, and I was quite happy with it, and I started doing some Golden Axe 2 artwork, and it occurred to me that there's nothing really, now that I've done a few of these, there's nothing really stopping me testing whether this would visually work on a Spectrum, so I started messing about. I made the Golden Axe 2 demo, loved the Mega Drive game, really got into it, thought, well, why not give it a go? As you can see, this text scrolled one pixel at a time up the screen slowly so you can read it. It's text from the Mega Drive version, so the English is terrible. Well, not terrible, but it's just badly written. not my fault. you see, there's multiple colours going on in the background there, and the way I've got around it is just sticking a big black border around the text so it can move one pixel at a time, and whatever's happening behind the black can happen. Seems to work pretty well. The background can move one pixel at a time as well for a nice slow scroll, and the dark blue gives it a sense that it's faded to the background, but also is actually more of a technical thing to allow it to scroll slowly. Here we go. So I've tried to capture the essence of Golden Axe 2. I also didn't like the way the music in the Mega Drive version went to that kind of poppy tune from this one, so I've kept this one on loop. I couldn't get my AY music editor to do the right rhythm for the Golden Axe 2 intro music, so I ended up with this kind of march, same melody but with this march. I think it works much better. It's kind of foreboding. I like it. I did the music and the graphics and the code for this as well in Adobe Director, which I love using. It's just something for fun. Occasionally make games in it. Now I'm trying not to muffle my microphone. hopefully you can still hear me. Let's play the game. There's the keys. Because it's a demo, I didn't go all full out front end. And I've tried to simulate that rotating screen thing with 8x8s and not very much programming knowledge. Choose characters. Who shall we pick? Axe Battler. There he is. So I drew the sprite. A few frames of it, and I really enjoyed doing it. And then I realised this could work as a little go at the game. So I put a couple of months of evenings into this. This is before we had the baby, of course. And it came out like this. It's moving 8x8. It's running at about 12 frames a second, if I remember right. No, you don't. And while my coding doesn't get the AI of Golden Axe quite right, as you can see, they're pretty close. Like in the original game, they don't gang up in front of you like that. They will go behind you if there's a space. I hadn't figured out the code for doing that. I'm making a brawler at the moment, and I'm still figuring out the code. I've been figuring out that code since I was about 19, and I first used DirectX to make the brawler. I remember walking down the street in Bradford, where I was living as a student, and the pseudo code for that was springing to mind. I've never managed to get it right. I know, it's a funny, one little funny thing, isn't it, that I should have been able to do, and I couldn't. I still couldn't when I was making this Golden Axe game. But I do think it really feels like the original Golden Axe 2, so I was quite pleased with it. Obviously I couldn't make any money out of it and I wouldn't want it. It was just something I wanted to do for the love of it. They are after ganging up though. But this version do have the advantage of being able to outwit them, because, you know, crowd them all up on one side here. As you can hear, the music's there. I made it on a little AY editor. Is it AY? Is that the right term? Spectrum music? It's got three channels playing. One thing it doesn't do is it doesn't, because this is a Shockwave Gamma Spectrum game, it plays four channels effectively, because it's playing the sound effects as well. What it would do, of course, on the Spectrum is use one of those sound effects as the one of those channels for sound effects, whatever they came up, cutting out the whatever music channel's playing at the time. Pick the least intrusive music channel, of course, to get rid of, so that you wouldn't really notice. So on an actual Spectrum, it wouldn't be quite as smooth audio-wise. Ooh, as you can see, the dragons are in there, the Berserians. They work pretty well. I defy anyone to tell me that 8x8 doesn't work for this, as long as you drop the frame rate. I don't know if you can write the code on a Spectrum to drop the frame rate. I'm sure you can, but people probably want it as high a frame rate as possible. The thing is, by taking the knock on the frame rate, you actually make a smoother game. You control it, the speed of the game with the frame rate. And let's face it, a lot of games on the Spectrum that were like this, when they attempted to play music, for example, Shadow Warriors, at the end of a level, played a little musical jingle. And when it did, it lost, it slowed down a lot. It's doing quite well in this Berseria. I know there's a few bugs around this Berseria. Hey, but we're not going to see him because it's gone. If I hold down the M key, the Simon Magic's building up. Let's go. Oh yeah, not quite full magic, but pretty good. Well, that took out all the baddies. Let's take out the boss. Maybe it's quite hard where, because he's got a fast attack. Gotta get in there quick. It's good though, isn't it? It's like Goldmax. Goldmax 2. The Mega Drive version, which no one really liked except me. Because it felt like Goldmax 2. Ow. Come on, get up. Okay, got him hacking down. He's gotta be nearly dead now. He's dead. That's unlimited, the sound effects, so it's definitely like three death cries. One's high, one's low, one's middle. The high one's like a girl squeal, like in Double Dragon on the Spectrum. That kind of woo noise. And I think the little elves do it as well. If I can actually hit them. Oh, yes, right. There we go. Maybe not. Maybe they don't do the squeal. But there we go. And that was it. That's all I coded. But the infrastructure's there for the rest of it. Now, I've just had a summon from the other half, so she's up with the Baba. So I'm going to go, but that was basically a little taste of my Spectrum art. I don't know if I'll do any more. It's time. As you can see, I don't have much time. That's definitely my other half. Right, I'll go, but thanks for watching. Let me know if you want to see anything else like that, and I'll do it. Bye for now.